Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to YU. So far, we have discussed polynomial functions and showed that their graphs can have interesting and varied shapes. As in previous lectures, the polynomial functions we will be discussing are functions of a single real variable x. But given a particular polynomial function, how can we produce that function's graph? There are various graphing utilities that are capable of creating accurate graphs of polynomial functions. However, it is often desirable to sketch a quick representation of a function's graph to get a general idea of its behavior. In this lecture, we will see how this can be accomplished. The graphs of all polynomial functions have certain similar characteristics. For instance, the graphs of polynomials are continuous. This means that their graphs have no breaks or jumps, so the line of the graph is uninterrupted. A simple way of thinking of a continuous graph is that it can be drawn in a single stroke without lifting your pen off the paper. Functions that are not continuous are said to be discontinuous. There are a number of ways that a function can be discontinuous. Take, for example, the function 1 over x. This function is discontinuous at an x value of 0. At that point, there is a break in the graph called a discontinuity. When the values of x are small, the function 1 over x is large. The function grows infinitely positive as x approaches 0 from the right, and infinitely negative as x approaches 0 from the left. Notice that when x is 0, the value of 1 divided by 0 is undefined. Therefore, the function's domain includes all values of x except 0. Another way that a function can be discontinuous is for a finite jump to occur in its graph. For example, consider the function x divided by the absolute value of x. When x is positive, the value of x and its absolute value are the same, so x divided by its absolute value is 1. On the other hand, when x is negative, x and its absolute value have the same magnitude but opposite signs. So in that case, x divided by its absolute value is negative 1. Notice that when x is 0, x and its absolute value are both 0. Since 0 divided by 0 is undefined, the function's domain includes all values of x except 0. An additional type of discontinuity is a single point missing from an otherwise continuous interval of a graph. An example of this is illustrated by the function x squared divided by x. The value of the function x squared divided by x is the same as the value of the function f of x equals x for all values of x except when x is 0. In that case, evaluating x squared divided by x gives us 0 divided by 0, which is undefined. Therefore, this function's domain includes all values of x except 0, and its graph does not include that single point at the origin. There are many other variations on discontinuities, but the important point is that polynomial functions are continuous, and so their graphs have no gaps, jumps, or other discontinuities. One additional feature shared by all polynomial functions is that their graphs are smooth. So what exactly is meant by the term smooth? A graph that is smooth has no sharp corners. Its slope is continuous at every point, never instantaneously changing to a new value. An example of a function that is not smooth is the absolute value of x. For positive values of x, its graph has a slope of 1. And when x is negative, its graph has a slope of negative 1. At the origin, the graph's slope instantaneously changes value, jumping from negative 1 to 1 as the value of x goes from negative to positive. Therefore, this function and its graph are not smooth. However, since the function is defined at every point, including when x is 0, the line of the graph is uninterrupted, and therefore the function is continuous. Concepts such as continuity and smoothness will become more important later when studying calculus. But knowing that all polynomial functions are continuous and smooth gives us some guidance when sketching a polynomial function's graph. So how do we go about sketching the graph of a polynomial function? The graph of a function is a visual representation of the function's output values over some range of input values. The domain of polynomial functions includes the set of all real numbers extending infinitely in both the negative and positive directions. But when creating a graph, we would like to select a subset of this domain that displays the most interesting or important characteristics of the function. For instance, we could choose to graph the function x cubed plus x squared minus 2x for input values between negative 50 and positive 50. But if instead we select a more limited set of input values, we get a more informative graph. Although this graph shows only a small portion of the function's domain, it gives us a better idea about the function's general behavior. This example also illustrates that the graph's x-intercepts, which are the points where the function's graph intersects the x-axis, can often indicate a region of the function's domain that will produce the most interesting graph. In this example, at each of its three intercepts, the graph crosses the x-axis and therefore has opposite signs on either side of the intercept. For example, at the intercept negative 2, 0, the graph is negative on one side and positive on the other. Likewise, at the intercept at the origin, the graph is positive on one side and negative on the other. And at the intercept 1, 0, the graph is once again negative on one side and positive on the other. However, at an x-intercept, it is also possible for a graph to intersect the x-axis and then bounce back without crossing it. In that case, the sign of the function's value will remain the same on both sides of the intercept. So the x-intercepts are important points to identify when sketching the graph of a polynomial function. These x values are called the zeros of the function, since they're the values of x where the function's output value is zero. The zeros of a function are also the solutions to the equation produced by setting that function equal to zero. For example, x equals 1 and x equals negative 2 are the solutions to the equation x cubed minus 3x plus 2 equals 0. These solutions are also called roots of the function and have been an area of great interest in mathematics for many centuries. So how do we go about finding these roots? When we first studied linear functions, which are first-degree polynomial functions, we saw that the solution to the corresponding linear equation produced by setting that function equal to zero could always be found by adding, subtracting, multiplying, or dividing terms until the variable x is alone on one side of the equation. likewise. When we studied quadratic functions, which are second-degree polynomial functions, we saw that the solutions to the corresponding quadratic equation could be found by factoring the polynomial into a pair of linear terms. Once we have factored the polynomial, the solutions to the quadratic equation can be determined by using the zero product property, setting each term equal to zero, and then solving the two resulting linear equations. As we also saw, in cases where factoring the quadratic is difficult, the solutions to the corresponding quadratic equation can always be found using the quadratic formula. This famous formula works in every case, producing the roots of any second-degree single-variable polynomial equation. So we know that the roots of first- and second-degree polynomial functions can always be found. But what about the roots of higher-degree polynomials? In fact, there are algebraic methods for finding the roots of any third-degree cubic polynomial function or fourth-degree quartic polynomial function. However, the methods that work in every case can be extremely complicated and often impractical to use. In addition, no general methodology exists for calculating the roots of polynomials of degrees higher than 4, although these roots can be approximated using computational techniques. But all is not lost. Polynomial functions of degree higher than 2 can often be easily factored into products of first-degree polynomials whose roots can then be found. The zero product property tells us that those roots will also be the roots of the higher-degree polynomial function. For example, let's say we want to find the roots of the third-degree polynomial function x cubed plus x squared minus 2x. Since x is a common factor in each of the three terms, we can factor this third-degree polynomial into a product of x times a second-degree polynomial. That second-degree polynomial can then be factored into the product of two first-degree polynomials. The roots can then be determined, setting each term equal to zero and solving the three resulting linear equations. These x values are the roots of the polynomial function and the x-intercepts of that function's graph. Once the x-intercepts of the function's graph have been determined, we know that the graph must intersect the x-axis at each of these points. Since these x values are the function's only roots, we also know that its graph cannot intersect the x-axis anywhere else. Therefore, between each consecutive pair of points, the graph must either lie entirely above or entirely below the x-axis. However, there are many shapes that a graph could take while intersecting the x-axis at only these three points. In the next lecture, we will see how to choose between these various possibilities and sketch the approximate shape of the polynomial function's graph once we know its roots and thus its x-intercepts.